Lord be with you. Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus, again, in reply, spoke to the chief priests and elders of the people in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. He dispatched his servants to summon the invited guests to the feast, but they refused to come. A second time, he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those invited, behold, I've prepared my banquet. My calves and fatted cattle are killed, and everything is ready. Come to the feast.' Some ignored the invitation and went away, one to his farm, another to his business. The rest laid hold of his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged and sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The feast is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy to come. Go out, therefore, into the main roads and invite to the feast whomever you find.' The servants went out into the streets and gathered all they found, the bad and the good alike. The hall was filled with guests. Then the king came in to meet the guests. He saw a man there not dressed in a wedding garment. And the king said to him, 'My friend, how is it that you had come in here without a wedding garment?' But he was reduced to silence. And then the king said to his attendants, 'Bind his hands and feet and cast him into the darkness outside, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Many are invited. Few are chosen.'" The Gospel of the Lord. You may not recognize it, but me and those who are ministering at funerals often recognize the first reading is very often read at a funeral. And so I'm so confused by the readings this week. I don't know if we're talking about a funeral or a wedding, whether we're talking about life or death, whether we're talking about joy, celebration, or sorrow and crying. Maybe we're talking about all of them. The first reading is the prophet Isaiah prophesying that our God will come to save us from the veil that veils all people, which claims his death, but also, I would add, the death that comes from sin. And the image is of a feast. That those longing for God's justice, starving and longing and yearning, will one day be satisfied. And so Jesus picks up on that same image in the Gospel, inviting everyone to this feast. And not everyone accepts the invitation. That really, I think, is a big part of the meaning of the Gospel. A lot of times we think of our religion as something we have to do, as an obligation, as a burden. But God is saying, no, it's a great feast. And I'm inviting you to something beyond what you can imagine. But all the sadness you can hear in the king who wants to celebrate with his subjects over the wedding of his son. celebration. Everyone's invited, but some go away to their farm, their business. How often do we and people I talk to, oh, I don't have time to do all that stuff, I have to work. But yet, anything we have in this life is so small compared to what God wants us to do and enjoy and be a part of. And so you can hear a sadness in those who feel that there's more important things to do. It's because of ignorance. We don't recognize that God is inviting us to. And there's those that are hostile or resistant to fight the invitation. Many of those we encounter too. And sometimes, I don't know the source of that fighting. I can't really call that sometimes, but I do know that some of those who fight, like St. Paul, one day became the most zealous advocate for the kingdom. So we must never give up hope for ourselves or others that seem to oppose. Then there's the most curious part when the king comes in and finds the person who did come in, right? The good and the bad were invited into the kingdom. Banquet. And yet, the king comes in and finds someone in a wedding garment and says, you're not worthy to be here, be cast out. That's a little confusing, isn't it? Well, I think the interpretation that I see is that, yes, everyone's invited to the kingdom, but it must change us. But sometimes we don't want to do the right thing, and when we're outside the kingdom, it's hard to come in. But God is saying, come on in anyway, as you are. It's imperfect as you are. Also, once you get here, allow yourself to be changed. The kingdom of God must continually be open to putting on Christ. God transforms us. We come in to the kingdom through our baptism, come into church, come into our prayer, come into our service, imperfect. And it's good to force ourselves sometimes to do the right thing. But give God a chance to transform our hearts. Fill us with joy. Secret treasure that God wants to give us, even in an imperfect world, that can change our hearts. And that's putting on the wedding garment, it's putting on Christ. St. Paul is talking about it in his second reading. Brothers and sisters, I know how to live in humble circumstances. I also know how to live in abundance. Is it hard to live in abundance? Secrets I have learned of being well-fed and of going hungry, of living in abundance and being in need. I can do all things in Him who strengthens me. We must put on Christ. The secret of life in both good times and in bad times is to die. Die to ourselves and our self-will and our own agendas and our own business. Put God first. Enter into the banquet. Now only very imperfectly, foreshadowed by this imperfect meal we're about to share to our human senses that is truly Christ and the fullness of His blessings and the inheritance of heaven. That will transform us. So that, in good times or in bad times, we have the secret living in the kingdom. Christ in us. That is God to ourselves. Us in our world where there is both still the good and the bad, and Christ needs more than those who will follow His way, put on the wedding garment, and live in the midst of our brothers and sisters, and proclaim the love.